The first people living here were the Anishinaabe, better known perhaps as Ojibwe or Chippewa. They called this place Bawating, which means place of the rapids.
It was those rapids that pooled the whitefish, that drew the Anishinaabe here. Rapids that centuries later would spur the construction of the locks, that would serve as the boundary between two nations. Rapids that would impact for more than 400 years a place Father Jacques Marquette named Sault Ste. Marie.
The very name means the falls of the St. Mary's River.
At the time the Pilgrims were at Plymouth Rock, on the fringe of the New World, French missionaries were already deep in its interior, here in the Sioux.
We can lay claim to being the first European settlement in what was to become the state of Michigan, yes, at 1668. There's a period in the Sioux's history, let's say from 1700 to late 1740s, when very little is recorded.
Because very few people actually called this place home. The threat of war would change that.
In 1751, a French fort was established. The French and Indian War was about to start up, and there was the British and the French were contesting for the interior of North America.
The war would pass, but the foundation for the Sioux's future would remain.
The American government wanted to plant the flag, so to speak, and so in 1820, Territorial Governor Cass led an expedition, came through the Sioux, got a treaty with the Ojibwe here for a grant of land in essentially what is now pretty much coincides with the city of Sault Ste. Marie. And so in 1822, a fort was built here, Fort Brady.
The fort stood here on what would become Water Street. With soldiers came opportunities in the form of hotels, saloons, billiard halls. A fledgling business district took root.
For probably 50 years at least, Water Street was the main commercial area for Sault Ste. Marie.
What took decades to build was wiped out in a single day by the biggest threat to a wooden downtown. The Sioux would rebuild further to the south on higher ground. But back at the waterfront, a different construction project was taking shape, something to deal with those rapids.
There was enormous pressure to try to get rid of this barrier of the rapids.
Something had to be done to move the cargo-heavy ships, 21 feet down or up, the elevation difference between Lake Superior and the St. Mary's. The solution was simple, build locks. And over the years, the Sioux built a lot of them.
First locks were opened here in 1855. Then the shipping just really took off.
With locks and freighters came new industry along the river, electrical generation, Union Carbide, and Northwestern Leather Company.
They were major in World War II, producing leather for boots for our troops.
Once again, the threat of war shaped the Sioux. These locks fed the steel mills that were driving the war effort in World War II. To protect them, the Sioux saw a boom.
We had over 7,000 troops attached to Fort Brady during World War II.
When the war ended, the troops went home, and there was little purpose for a military fort here. But these buildings wouldn't sit empty for very long. Replacing soldiers preparing for war were students preparing for a life at what would become Lake Superior State University. Over the years, the Sioux has battled against and capitalized on those rapids. For freighters, the solution was in place. For drivers, it took a little longer.
For many years, the traffic went by ferry, but in 1962, the International Bridge for trucks and cars opened up. So we're coming on the 50th anniversary this summer. There'll be some celebrations.
Today, the Sioux is a melting pot, a town of industry, of hope, of resilient people, with a rich history that flows like a river.